Hi guys, welcome to Better Data Science. Today I want to quickly discuss the recent release of the M1 Pro and Max MacBooks from Apple. I'm a big Apple fan. I own a M1 MacBook Pro, iPhone 12 Pro and the AirPods Pro. The Mac is just an amazing piece of technology, especially with the Apple Silicon or the M1 chip that was introduced last year. I brought my M1 MacBook Pro then, and I can genuinely say that there's no laptop on the market on which I'd rather work on. The improved M1 chip was announced a week ago, so you can buy even stronger MacBooks in the entire world as of yesterday. The only question remains, should you do it, or is the regular M1 enough for data science and machine learning workflows? I'll try to answer that question in today's video. But before starting, let me just say that I'm recording this video from a data scientist perspective. I don't care for 8K video rendering or having a gazillion tracks in Logic Pro. I have a 2020 M1 MacBook Pro and do most of the heavy lifting on remote GPU machines, so have that in mind while watching the video. I waited so long for the new line of Apple Silicon MacBooks. I own a M1 MacBook Pro and I love everything about it. It's crazy fast, lightweight, completely silent, has excellent screen and keyboard, doesn't overheat and has all day battery life. In short, there's no way I'm going back to Windows or Linux anytime soon. After watching Apple's event on the 18th of October, I have two things to say. The new M1 Pro and Max chips are groundbreaking and there's no way I'm buying them as a data scientist. I have three solid reasons why. Let's dive into the first one. The first reason is that the regular M1 MacBook is good enough. I'd love to throw every data science and deep learning benchmark at the new machines and compare the performance. I'm certain I'd be amazed by how much faster the new machines are. But ignoring the added cores and RAM, M1 Pro and Max are still the same as the regular M1, as they don't support more data science tools and libraries. You'll still struggle when installing TensorFlow, but once installed, it will run a bit faster. It's not a big deal since no one's using thin and lightweight laptops for serious deep learning anyway. What I do care about is battery life. Apple claims a 17 or 21 hour battery life depending on if you go for a 14 inch or 16 inch model. That claim is only valid for base models, and the battery life likely gets worse the more you spec the machine. On the other hand, the regular M1 MacBook Pro already has an outstanding battery life. I can easily get 1 to 2 work days with a single charge, provided I don't do anything crazy. Let's talk about the design. Sure, the new models have thinner bezels, a better screen and a nicer keyboard, but it's honestly not the redesign I was looking for. Compared to the redesign from 2016, this year looks more like a retouch. As a data scientist, I don't care that much about the laptop design since it's closed and plugged into an external monitor 80% of the time. I use a single 4K monitor, but if you need more, the regular M1 isn't for you as it only supports one external display. On the other hand, you can drive 3 6K displays plus an additional 4K TV with the new chip. It's amazing, sure, but I don't have that setup, so it means nothing to me. The second reason is that the new MacBooks are just too expensive. I hate discussing money in absolute terms. $1,000 isn't much to an American, but it's more than a monthly median net salary in Croatia. People in the US talk about how expensive these new machines are, but I think they got it good. I found that the monthly median net salary in the United States is just under $4,000. If that's true, you can buy almost any new MacBook with a single paycheck. But not everyone has the privilege of living in the States. Here's how much the new MacBooks cost in my country, which is Croatia. The HRK stands for Croatian kuna, which is a currency. The median monthly net salary was 6,000 kunas in March of 2021, so this is how many monthly salaries you would need to spend if you want to buy the new machines. And yeah, you're reading that right. I haven't covered custom configurations, so going all in with 64 gigs of RAM and 8 terabytes of storage would make your head spin. And wallet's empty, but that's a given. Data scientists make well above the median salary, but it's still a ton of money. If you wonder how much does the regular M1 lineup cost in comparison, I have you covered. The following table summarizes the 2020 M1 MacBook Air and Pro models available in stores, so no custom configurations. It's still expensive, sure, but not as much. You can get the most expensive M1 MacBook Pro with 16 gigs of RAM and 1/2 TB of SSD storage for less than the base 14-inch model, and save the remainder for, I don't know, monthly living costs. I know these machines are intended to pro users, or at least what Apple thinks a pro user is. If you're like me and do a lot of deep learning on remote machines with GPUs and use laptops just to connect to those machines, then you don't fit into the pro category. And that's completely fine. And the last reason is that I can't benefit from the added horsepower much. Saving a couple of minutes here and there is beneficial, sure, but not mandatory for what I do. My M1 MacBook Pro had zero hiccups since day one, and it only has 8 GB of RAM. I had Windows machines go nuts with Ryzen 7 and 16 GB of RAM. It's not a fair comparison in terms of horsepower, but they cost roughly the same. The only benefit I see from using a Windows or Linux machine is having more Python libraries available and having CUDA support, provided you have an NVIDIA GPU. I don't know how fast TensorFlow will run on the new MacBook lineup, but I assume it will be nothing short of breathtaking. In a nutshell, all I want as a data scientist is a thin and portable machine capable of doing anything you throw at it, within reason, with an amazing screen and battery life. 2020's M1 MacBook Pro and even Air match the description perfectly. The setup I have right now was considered groundbreaking a year ago, so how bad can it really be today? With all of that out of the way, I can comfortably say I'm waiting for the M2 chip next year. Don't get me wrong, I like mini LED screen technology, 120Hz refresh rate, added ports, multiple monitor output, and generally everything the new MacBook lineup has to offer. But for me, it's not enough to make the switch. There's no way to justify the cost, as I already have a perfectly capable machine. If I had any Intel-based MacBook, then it would be a whole different story. No one can tell what the future brings, but here's my forecast. The next year's M2 MacBook will replace the current regular M1 MacBook Air and Pro models. The big selling point for these models a year ago was $1,000 or $1,300 starting price, and I don't think Apple will change it much, if at all. I think M2 will bring most of what M1 Pro and Max offer today, and the redesign at a fraction of the cost. I might be completely wrong, but only time will tell. And that's all I have to say for today. Let's finish the video next. To summarize, the new MacBooks are crazy fast, and if you can benefit from the added horsepower, just go for it. But for me, the M1 from the last year is perfectly fine. The only thing that sucks right now is being on the Windows side, as I can't even imagine how well they compete with the new Macs. What are your thoughts on the new MacBook lineup as a data professional? Have you ordered one, and if so, from which machine are you upgrading? Also, how do you plan to benefit from the added horsepower as a data scientist? Please let me know in the comment section below. Also, if you're new here, please consider giving this video a thumbs up and subscribing to Better Data Science. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.